welcome once again to IGN's weekly PlayStation podcast. I'm your host, Max Scoville. This is episode 837. We should really call it episode 830 Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, because that is what we're going to be talking about today. I am joined by my Final Fantasy friends, Nick Limon, Michael Higham, who reviewed the game, and Jada Griffin. Beyond, everybody. What's up?
Beyond.
So,
is that what I'm supposed to say?
You got to say beyond. That's your, yeah.
That G is
doing a lot of work back here.
So Michael is a freelancer who's, you may know him from other, you know, GameSpot, other rival, you know, what is it? patriarch of the GameSpot family, subsidiary of the CBS Interactive clan or whatever.
No, we don't claim CBS no more.
Yeah, we're all pals though. So you reviewed Rebirth. Before we get into it too much, that's what we're going to be talking about today. We're just going to be talking about Final Fantasy Rebirth. We've collectively, I think, probably sunk 400 hours into it. Something? No, 350 hours.
No,
maybe?
No, we're probably up to 400 with me.
Okay, yeah, it is a massive, massive game. There's a lot to talk about. We are going to be steering as clear of spoilers as possible. I think there's plenty to touch on that is, not story spoilers or anything like that. That said, if you're trying to go in cold, maybe save this for after you've played a little bit more. I haven't finished the game yet. I think I sunk about 35 hours in, and I'm maybe halfway. How did all of you clock in for this, Nick?
For me, I finished the game last night, day before we're recording, and I ended up putting 89 hours in and 20 minutes. And that's doing I think I 97%ed the game, but those final 3%, I was like, nah, I think I'm gonna have to wait for that.
Michael, what about you?
Ooh, I came in at 82 hours by the time I wrapped up the game, and that I had to leave quite a few pieces of side content on the table just because of how demanding that stuff is. It's, and we'll talk about how like great a lot of that side content is, but it is a lot. I think a lot of people are going to underestimate how massive this game is. That was a good 82 hours. A lot of it was lost to playing Queen's Blood. Y'all ain't ready.
Love
for
me
that.
Some Queen's Blood. Love me some
Move
Queen's
over,
Blood.
Gwent.
Yeah.
Jada, what about you? What's your clock?
I am literally in the final fight right now. Literally paused in the final fight as of this morning. I am at a $120 for hours right now, and that's with every single side quest done, every single mini game, max score, perfect score, every Queen's Blood challenge done, every Chocobo race, everything like perfect, basically done across the board. Everybody's max leveled. Most of my materia is maxed. I have to finish the story before I can do a few more of the arena stuff that doesn't open up till you finish the campaign. But that's all I have left after I finish this final fight.
Teacher's pet over here. Good God.
I covered all the fog in the map. There's no fog on my map.
That's amazing. Yeah, no, so I mean, right off the bat, like, anybody who played the first one, like, that was, you know, that was what, like, around 30, if you just kind of...
Yeah, if you just ran it.
Mainland. Yeah, that was...
Mainline, yeah.
Honestly, that almost feels like... That almost feels like a demo by comparison. Like, that that feels like a, you know, a ground zeros to this is Phantom Pain, you know, like it is such a ridiculously huge departure. It's the overworld. It is a proper, they let you out. Let's just talk about that. Like the sheer scale of the world.
I'm curious about how they're going to do. Cause you know how that when you boot up this one, it has the story so far and they released a trailer and stuff like that. I am curious how they're going to fit all the story events so far for the third part, based on what we've seen. Like, that's going to be a 10-minute video, like, minimum, that we're going to have to watch.
So the story so far doesn't even touch on Crisis Core or Intergrid, I don't think. Because It does, I mean, the story so far. I mean, I'm sure the game touches on that, but, like, I was like,
oh, the story so far, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't play those. I should probably find out what's going on. And it's just, like, it just recaps the main game. And I was like, okay, well, I hope I don't, you know. There's a lot here. It is an open world game. It has some of the most, it has a lot of modern open world game sensibilities. Like it has towers you have to clear out. It has like, you know, little treasure hunts and activities and stuff like that. It still does have some kind of like, I feel like vestigial remnants of, you know, classic JRPG overworld, you know, like there's definitely, there's a sense of a little bit of rigidity. Michael, you talk about sort of traversal being a little clunky in your review. You want to talk about that a little bit?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I mean, overall, I really like what they do with the open world in terms of how they kind of fill it in with tasks that feel meaningful, or at very least, they're fun to do. And like when you step into the grasslands, it's a more of a like a basic overworld to kind of get your feet wet in how this game actually functions. But once you go to the other regions, such as Junon and Corel, and the various other ones, which I mean, I'm not sure how y'all feel about actually naming them. If you've watched the state of play, you know where this game goes. If you played the original, you know where this goes. But as you unlock the chocobos to actually traverse those different areas, you see that they're kind of built differently, where one of the regions feels more like a labyrinthian maze, and you have to kind of figure out how these launch pads take you to one section of the map, as opposed to just like walking over there. Because in the grasslands, if you see something out in the distance, you might have to take a detour to get to that point, as you have to do with some of the side quests. But as you get on and on, these things get a little bit more complicated. And I appreciate the break in pace and how traversing the overworld kind of becomes part of the process, and how you engage with the game itself, rather than just like fast traveling to an icon or whatever, or just beelining it to whatever icon you mark on your map. So it becomes a part of the experience itself, figuring out how to actually navigate this world. That does cause some frustrations, though, because they try to get cute with it with a lot of different gimmicks, especially like in the Cosmo Canyon region and how your chocobo takes flight and all this. And I guess becomes a little bit much, but I do appreciate that they try to keep things varied as you go on in the game, because this is such a long game, and I think you can run into a lot of repetition with open world style games that do last this long. So I like the idea. Sometimes the execution isn't fully there. So that's just one thing that I definitely have noticed and took into consideration.
Yeah, go ahead, Max.
I was going to say, they kind of showed this off in the state of play. Like, we get a sense of the different, you know, the different ways you can get around. I remember a lot of us early on were like, wait, you get a Segway? Like, why? And it completely makes sense in the context of the game. Like, it actually, I was kind of surprised at how ordinary it feels and how it works. That Segway absolutely mops the floor with the one from Yakuza. I really hate to just kind of come out and say that. I think it's just... It is far away.
You don't have to pay to recharge it. Is that why?
You don't have to pay to recharge it. It is fast as hell. It got the adaptive triggers on there. It's great. It's a great time. Really, just
I can't put sick flames on it though.
That's true. But
ones to choose from. You got multiple ones to choose from. So there you go.
Yeah. As for customization, we do get to dress up our chocobos quite a bit. There's a lot of this is honestly like trying to talk about a game of this scale. It's always kind of hard to just kind of come out somewhere. Hi, we've got four people who've sunk hundreds of hours into this thing. What do we talk about? I don't know. Chocobo hats. Like, you don't even know. Like, there's no sensible way to kind of get off the ground here. But like, yeah, I want to just.
My partner had mentioned a character he saw in a cutscene, and I was like, what character are you talking about? And I had to think, because it was like 30 hours since I had seen this character. And I was like, oh, that's the guy you were talking about. Like, there's just so much in this game. To Michael's point about like how, you know, repetition and stuff and being worried about that with the chocobos changing, I started to feel a little bit of that kind of burnout of repetition around like, what is it? I think chapter 4 or 5, because I felt like I was doing the same thing over and over again. But then the next couple chapters starts to vary it. And then they did a really good job with the pacing in this one, because as soon as I finished, I think it was like 6, 7, and 8 chapters, like it went back to doing other stuff. And I was like, oh, the repetition doesn't feel like overused anymore. Like they did a really good job with the pacing in this one. So, but yeah, there's so much stuff. Speaking of chocobo hats, I have so many chocobo hats for my chocobo. Like my chocobo looks like a big dork. Whereas like almost like a Mad Hatter kind of like Alice in Wonderland hat.
I would hope your chocobo is the stupidest looking bird I've ever seen.
I think my main I won all the races with my yellow chocobo. I didn't use any of the other colored chocobos for the races. But I think my go-to was like this like goofy ceremonial like Mad Hatter hat, a Hawaiian scarf shirt that it wears. Yeah. And then I switched the like leg guards between these like leather paddings or these like dragon plated guardings or whatnot, just depending on what courses I'm racing on.
This is what people want to hear about when we talk about this highly anticipated PlayStation 5 console exclusive, massively anticipated sequel. We should talk about the core combat experience, because I feel like it. If you play the last one, if you didn't play the last one, what are you doing? I don't know why you would. This is not going to make any sense. But it takes a lot of the systems introduced there, which were good. It was a really there was a very solid foundation there. It really expands on it in a super fun and interesting way. And I think the big thing, obviously, is like synergy attacks. Like, Michael, can you explain synergy attacks concisely?
Yes. This is all right. I did this in writing. Let me see if I can do this here. Synergy attacks are basically partner-based abilities that you kind of build on through what are called. Let me take it back a step, actually. So folios are like a sphere grid, and these sphere grids are for each character, and you get a pool of skill points to spend on unlocking things in you. I'm just going to call it sphere grid because I think that's a universal language that Final Fantasy people understand. Here they're called 100%. Folios. Let's call it sphere grid. But you end up getting specific partner attacks for specific combinations of characters. So like Cloud and Barrett have their own. Yuffie and Tifa will have their own. Everyone will have their own combination of synergy attacks. And these kind of, I describe them as attacks that can fill in the gaps in battle. So you're not just waiting to build ATB. You have something to work with. So the way it works is like the more that character spends, if they spend an ATB bar, they get one charge towards a synergy attack. And usually they take like three or four for each character to unlock a synergy attack in battle. And you can use that free of ATB. So it's something to work towards and kind of another way to encourage you to be aggressive in combat. It's like, yo, I really want to use the synergy attack because not only does it put on a bunch of damage, but then it can either like give you unlimited MP for a certain amount of time. It could fill your limit gauge bar. There's always an incentive that you get on top of doing the damage with the partner attack. So it's kind of giving you an extra tool and a toolbox that was already kind of an embarrassment of riches, I think.
I feel like you kind of, in your review, you talk about how it's sort of, it feels like a missing component almost. Mm-hmm. And honestly, there's sort of an interesting loop here where basically, you know, you go in and you kick some ass, you block some stuff to build up your ATB gauge, you fill up your ATB gauge, you do, you know, abilities or spells or whatever. And then spending those ATB bars lets you do synergy attack. And one of them splits your ATB gauge. So you can have like, you can basically do more of that. So it kind of like, it sort of snowballs. I was totally expecting these to just be like, you know, buddy powered special moves, but it's like considerably more complex than that. And also like it sort of devalues them if you use them the same one too much, or like
it raises the cost. So like Barrett and Clouds, like they'll raise your limit break level by one, and I think at level when you first use the ability it costs 3 synergy bars for each character. And then if you want to do it again with them, it costs 5 synergy bars to raise their limit break to level 3. I really like the system. It encourages you to swap between characters, because I noticed a lot of times early on I wasn't getting a lot of synergy attacks, and it's because I was just sitting there mainlining Cloud. I was like, I'm only using Cloud right now. It's like, oh, I probably should switch over to Barrett and use some of his abilities. And that kind of really forced me to start building my characters almost class-based. So I turned Barrett into like a full-on tank healer. Like, he just is all about like absorbing all the damage from everybody. Like if you played Remake, his lifesaver ability is back, so he takes all the damage for everybody. And then I just gave him a chakra material, so then he just regens a bunch of HP for one section of ATB and charges his synergy gauge. So I just did that a bunch with him, and I did the same thing with other characters. But yeah,
I think it's also just the mark of an inherent good system of designs that all work together to kind of complement one another, to kind of just make you have the most fun at all times when you are playing through the game. And I think it's also reflected in the open world. I think all of the side content works together to get you to discover other side content. So too does the combat system not only build off what was established with Remake, which looking back now, Remake is just completely primitive. And then we see Intermission evolve that a little bit further with the synergy skills between Sonon and Yuffie, and this takes that to another level entirely, taking everything that made Final Fantasy Final Fantasy in the PlayStation 1 era, you know, known for its CG graphics, that you would play the game to look at these visual spectacles, and now in the era of PS5, we kind of take it for granted. So I think what they do a good job of is taking those cinematic spectacles and adding them to combat, making them playable. You know, we always used to have the complaint, why can't my characters do all the cool stuff that they do in the cutscenes? Well, in Rebirth, you can. You know, I forget the name of the synergy skill, but seeing Barrett and Aerith team up and Aerith puts on Barrett sunglasses.
Sweet and sour salvo.
Dude, it's just, it's so cinematic, it's fun, and it's showing you not just cool stuff on screen, but it highlights and really makes each character feel like a character with their own distinct playstyle and personality. Like, it's kind of nuts how every single character in this game could kind of be the star in their own AAA action RPG, where it's like, oh, do you want to play a brawler like Yakuza? Hey, you have Tifa. Do you want to play like a shooter that's like all about kind of laying back and, you know, pelting enemies with gunfire and also healing allies? That's Barrett. Yuffie's like a quadruple A character in of her own right. So it's just like nuts how all of these different characters work together to just make something feel so good and fun.
Yeah.
So yeah, you're juggling, let's see, you're juggling not just individual character levels, you're figuring out like their weapon levels, your material levels, your party's entire level, what your party members think of you, how happy they are with you. You've got your folios, and then you've got like, you've got, you know, in moment to moment, you're building up ATB to spend to build up synergy attacks. Like, there's so many different, like, just so many different systems. Like, it is so deep. And again, you're playing with three characters at a time out of a, you know, increasingly growing roster of people to pull from, and you obviously want to, you know, you want to hop around so everyone gets a chance to play. And it just feels sizably, considerably more noticeable of a experience in terms of like compared to the first one. Like, it's just, there's a lot more there to figure out, which is good, because you've got, you know, if you're spending 100+ hours doing that, keeps you from getting bored. Like, it's huge.
Yeah. And like, having every character be so distinct in their play style means like it, like, I love switching characters because like, oh, I can do something completely different if I'm just controlling Cloud the whole time. It's like, okay, I get into the flow of how to play like a swordsman. But man, I love switching to Yuffie because she has so much flexibility and mobility.
She's so fun.
She's like, I love to integrate, but now that she's like now with a full party, controllable, now you can like play off of her strengths as well with like her different ninjutsu and her doppelganger, and she could really bring enemy stagger bars all the way up while you tee up like Cloud and Tifa for their big hitting attacks. So when you do stagger an enemy, you can just lay it on them. And on top of like the way pressure and stagger works in this game as well, that of course that's borrowed from Remake as well, but like the deeper you get in like boss fights and some of the like higher level enemies, the specific conditions in which you need to engage with the combat system to inflict pressure and then get a stagger is really thoughtful. So you're not just like mashing square or hoping to build ATB so you can get off like Comet or Fireaga or whatever hard-hitting spell is. Like, those things aren't really effective unless you use them at the right time and on the right enemies. So there's not only are you juggling so many different mechanics in a pretty complex combat system, but now you have to think about how to engage specific enemies and what makes them tick. And some of them don't even have elemental weaknesses too. It's like, if they use this attack, you have maybe a 5-second window to hit them to inflict pressure. And if you miss this, then you're kind of screwed. And there's so many variations of that. So it's almost intimidating when I try to explain it to people, or if I try to like really sit down and think about what this combat system is doing. So I can imagine someone looking at this and be like, yo, that's a lot. You're doing a lot. But trust me, what's it like? The way the game builds on it, it doesn't like throw everything at you at once. The way it like slowly builds you into understanding how these things work, especially with a lot of the side content that is built to teach you the intricacies of the game. Once it all starts to click, there is just nothing like Rebirth's combat system. I played so many RPGs in my lifetime. I love my turn-based games. Y'all should check out my Persona 3 Reload review on IGN.com as well. Probably one of my favorite games of all time. But the thing about Rebirth, I have to say, is that there is just nothing like this combat system. It is sometimes so frustrating with the way some of the enemies are designed, but when it all clicks, oh my god, it is something special. I
mean, some of the summon fights, especially, like, you have to be very so careful fun. With some of those summon fights. Like, there's one of them that you have to debuff. Like, you have, I was like, I'm not using bringing deep protect or deep brave or deep shell like on a regular fight. Like, it's just not useful. And you get to this one fight and it's like, oh, you need to cast these to pressure them. I'm like, oh, well, I guess I need to go and equip those materials. Mm-hmm. Like, hope I leveled them up. Mm-hmm.
So. Now, it's like, obviously, the last big JRPG was, well, I mean, no, there was Persona. It's been a big year for JRPGs. Mm-hmm. There was Persona 3 Reload, but I think the interesting one to compare this to is Infinite Wealth with Infinite Wealth, you know, yeah. Like a Dragon. And it's, we were talking about this before the show, but it's like very clear that like these devs are kind of, they're kind of copying each other's homework, but there's like, obviously, like, it, you know, coming from a place of respect. It's also extremely funny that, like, this is, you know, this is one of the most beloved turn-based games ever. And they were like, nah, it's a beat 'em up now. And then, like, you know, Yakuza, they put out what, 9 games. And then they were like, nah, it's turn-based now. And yeah. Both of these do an interesting thing where they're not so rigidly departing from like what they used, like in the same way that Yakuza is like, it's turn-based, but there's like a margin of real-time activity in the moment-to-moment like combat scenarios. In this case, you're still swapping between characters and like basically stopping down. And it's like, it's not turn-based, but you go into that sort of bullet time, like slow-mo to, you know, to assign party members to do stuff. And that's sort of turn-based, you know? Mm-hmm.
There's a healthy equilibrium that's happening here with the Like a Dragon franchise and Final Fantasy as a whole, where Like a Dragon is an action RPG with a heavy emphasis on the RPG turn-basedness of it, whereas the Final Fantasy VII Rebirth is the opposite, where it is an action RPG that puts a lot more emphasis on action. To go back to Michael's cues of, you have to read your opponents, you have to see when they're about to anticipate attacks and hit them in certain moments and things like that. And it's just wonderful. You know, I remember a decade ago where people are like, turn-based RPGs are dead, they're not going to make any more of them. And now it's wonderful to see the genre thriving with two very different representations of kind of the same thing. And it's just like, turn-based RPGs are not dead, nor are action RPGs. They're just different now. And they're, I think, evolving. That difference exactly, they're evolving. And I think that's just the sign that it is a healthy genre that is still plenty of room to grow into, which
well,
is
also
exciting.
It's like cool as hell to see, you know, these massive established franchises that are known for a specific type of, you know, gameplay not be afraid to try something new and completely shake things up by like going a totally new direction. Like Final Fantasy's been doing real-time combat for like a minute now, but it's still like, it's still weird to kind of like, you know, reflect on that. You know why you don't need to reinvent the wheel, like, but what if you did, you know? What if you made the wheel cooler?
Yeah. So it feels like all these games are still very much in tune with their identity, especially like when I think about Infinite Wealth, that it still has that over the top ridiculousness. And, you know, when you control Kiryu in that game, it's like, oh, he's still a brawler too if you use his limit break. And that's like, hey, we haven't forgot that this is what Yakuza is about. Also, it can be multiple things. And I feel the same way about 7 Remake and 7 Rebirth, where you know, you still have all the elements that you remember from those games. It's just in tune in a different way, so the identity is never lost on you. And that's one thing, that's one of the many things that stood out when I played Remake, and that's still true with Rebirth. Speaking of the comparisons between Yakuza and Final Fantasy 7, I forgot how goofy 7 is, and it really leans into that. So you mentioned some of the partner attacks, and some of them are just, especially the one with Tifa and Red 13, I'm just like, what are we doing here, where Tifa like turns into a dog herself and they just wail on your enemy. I'm like, yeah, I'm on board with this, because it's so ridiculous. And I love that these games don't take themselves so seriously. That, you know, 7 was, the original 7 was still like a really dark game when I would like really reflect on the things that happened and how a lot of those moments were framed. And I think 7 Rebirth takes a lot more of a lighter tone compared to the original. But again, it doesn't feel like it's betraying the original identity of the game. So I love that levity that it provides.
I think it still gets pretty dark during those big story beats. And then there's some added story beats and stuff that kind of fills in the gaps that you didn't really, that was like, that are bigger or more, there's more to them. They've added more content to some of these story beats that do get to some decently dark places, kind of like the original. I think a lot of the levity comes from a lot of the side stuff, a lot of the in-between travel banter, travel dialogue, travel cutscenes and stuff like that when you're just kind of moving from location to location. I think, but yeah, I 100% agree. I love the levity. I think the word we've been throwing around as we've talked like offline about this is it's very Scooby-Doo. Like, this is the most Scooby-Doo kind of Final Fantasy game, and in the best possible way. And yes, Red 13 is Scooby Doo himself. Like,
no, we're talking about this. Like, the moment it hit me is there's a part where your party has to split up, and Barrett's like, I'm going to go downstairs with Red. Cloud, you hang out with Tifa and Aerith. And I'm like, that's like a Freddie Jones move. Be like, all right, Shag, you and Scoob go explore the kitchen. I'm going to hang out with the babes. And it's just like, what are you doing? You're going to solve a mystery.
I think, like, you know, it's such a daunting task to adapt the original Final Fantasy VII to modern day, because I think so much of the original game's identity is tied to the fact that it is, you know, launch software, you know, launch window software for the original PlayStation, right? Where, you know, the PlayStation was being fine-tuned to accommodate Final Fantasy VII and likewise. And so much of the restrictions on the original Final Fantasy VII, you know, the block cylindrical hands was by nature of they didn't know how to emote. So they would just have over-dramatic emotes in the original game, like squatting to showcase some sort of excitement and emotion. And I think that they've managed to take that original goofiness, that PS1-ness of the original Final Fantasy VII and preserve it, right? It is a snapshot of a game from the late 90s that was experimental. It was weird. And I think they managed to preserve it in amber in a way that feels Jurassic Park-esque, where they're just kind of resurrecting it and bringing it into a modern context. And with that new context, you're able to see it and appreciate it in new and fun ways.
Mm-hmm. No, I keep thinking about, like, obviously remakes are, you know, a divisive thing. It's sort of like, well, why not make something new? I'm so glad that we're getting stuff like this and like RE4 and hopefully, you know, Snake Eater, because these are things that if they weren't established, if they weren't like, if they didn't get weird 25 years ago, 20 years ago, they wouldn't be this weird now. Like, no. They would not have the, like, a new IP would, there's no way in a million years we would see a new IP that is this expensive, this polished, this ambitious, and this flat out stupid at times. Like, this is, I think, the most expensive piece of media I've consumed that is also this ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like,
and I think we're at, like, the period now that, I think we're in the period of video games now that film found itself in relatively like in the 80s and 90s, where, you know, you have your primitive, right? You have your classical film, you have your revisionist, and you have your parody. And I think right now video games find themselves in the revisionist period, where they are able to take the classics and kind of like, what if we took a sidestep over here a little bit to show off the heart? We learned a little bit more about the primitive. Like, we've evolved in developing these video games. And I think right now we are in this heyday of taking a look at what was before and allowing us to zig and zag in a lot more fun ways. And again, just another sign of a healthy, creative industry.
It reminds me of another thing that happened in 1997 that involved dudes named Biggs and Wedge, which was the Star Wars Special Edition. And like, that was, you know, infamous. Like, George Lucas was like, this is my original vision. I wanted the singing man to dance more. I wanted more of a musical number here. It was going to be very exciting. Wampa was going to be scarier. This I feel like does what he was trying to do, but it succeeds. This has a bunch of completely gaudy, over the top musical numbers, but they work. They make sense in the context of the game. You know, there's plenty of serious, dark, epic moments, but there's such, like, the thing that I cheered, I applauded when you got to the Hell House in Remake. Like, that was just such a, when they first announced this, they obviously, the reveal trailer for Remake was, like, very brooding and serious and, like, you know, it was badass. You know, it was Cloud with Materia and the Buster Sword. You're like, holy, they're doing it, holy shit. And, like, I'm like, okay, but here's a question. how are you going to fight a house? Like, how are they going to make a house fight work when you're also going for that serious tone? And they pulled that off. And in this case, it is, they're continuing to get that weird. They're continuing to get that silly. Like, there's so much stuff in here that's completely, utterly wackadoo, and it pays off. Like, they've earned it. And also, like, I don't know. I was texting a friend about this, but like, I feel like Remake, in comparison, like Remake is great. Like, there's a lot there. It's very impressive. You know, and obviously we finished that and we kind of, you know, there was, you kind of felt yourself like wanting more. Like, and there was also, I know there was a concern that, you know, this would, the second chunk of this would be another 30 hour experience and they would just be kind of selling us a massive game piecemeal. Clearly not the case. Like, this is a huge, you know, massive installment that they obviously, you know, they had to sell Remake at full price to, you know, probably recoup some losses and keep the coffers lined or whatever. The first one reminded me of Resident Evil 3 Remake in that it was like very polished, very cool, very slick, but there was also a feeling of like it was almost half baked, like it was sort of undercooked, like, and there was a sort of sense of like, this is really cool, I want something more ambitious. And I remember playing, you know, RE3 Remake and being like, I hope 4 doesn't pull back, you know, I hope that 4 is as big of an experience as the original is. And that is exactly what this feels like. In terms of sort of like Rebirth compared to Remake feels like, you know, RE4 Remake compared to 3 Remake. Like, it is, any concerns I had about it not, you know, not delivering, completely unfounded. Like, it is a huge, huge experience. And it doesn't sand off any of like the weird edges. Like, it is, again, it gets completely gaudy and ridiculous. And like, there's so much just, it allows itself to get weird and experiment and try new things. And like, I don't know. It just, we don't get things that are that out there in the AAA space, I feel like.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I feel like a lot of companies, they feel they need to play it safe when it comes to, you know, releasing, because it's 6-7 years worth of work. You know what I mean? Like, and this is their chance to make back what they've spent on it. So they've like, we've got to put our best foot forward. We've got to go with what we know works. And I'm very happy that this goes just so many different places and does so many, like, it zigs where you expect it to zag into so many different crazy things. Not everything does land. Some of the mini games are a little, they require a lot of work and they're not very fun. there's one called Gambits and Gears, which is later in the game. And I just really did not like that one. The Gambit system, yes, but man, oh, what a way to use it. But yeah, but everything else, like, it's so, like, it's just so well done. The comedy, the writing, the just everything. I love this game.
One big addition that we should probably talk about is Queen's Blood, which is, yes. this is the Gwent. This is the in-universe
triad
card game. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, I was surprised that they managed to, like, spotlight it so much, like, mm-hmm. it's common that like something like this gets unveiled and it's sort of like it's a sub story or a side quest. It doesn't usually wind up on the golden path, you know, like, you don't usually, if you're just like, I'm not going to mess with this, I'm just going to play the main game, you know, usually you don't encounter it again. Very much not the case here. There's like a completely like a very ridiculous like main storyline, but I don't want to spoil this, but like, it,
yeah,
you know, we probably all would have finished the game, or we probably would all have less time clocked if not for Queen's Gambit, yeah. Which is like it is very addictive. Are any of you like trading card game people or like board? I don't, is this, I guess it's like a deck builder type of thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
Like when it comes to Final Fantasy card games, I always get super into them. So like, mm-hmm. I mean, Triple Triad was like the first true attempt at a card game within a video game. And they really struck gold with that. And that exists in Final Fantasy 14. I have thousands of hours of Final Fantasy 14. I've collected almost all the Triple Triad cards that are in that one. I do not like Tetramaster from Final Fantasy 9.
Tetramaster is not fun.
Yeah, but I feel like they have something special here with Queen's Blood, because it starts off as something where you're just like doing territory control on it's a 5x3 grid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you think it's just like, oh, territory control with different grids and a sequence and logic to it all with the different cards that you have. It evolves in such a way that doesn't get overwhelming, but by the time you get to like the later Queen's Blood quests and some of the harder opponents that you can find later in the game, you are doing some wild stuff that you did not realize were possible when you first started playing Queen's Blood in it. And like the way it kind of teases you or like pushes you, encourages you to engage with it, because like, hey, we put a lot of thought and care into making this card game, please play it, and making that part of the main story in some way. And you can skip it if you want, if you really don't really want to engage mm-hmm. with card games, you have a way out. But if you just give it a chance, I think you'll find something that is digestible, that is good at teaching you the intricacies, much like the combat system. They're good at ramping you up in understanding how complex this game can be. And it is a worthwhile time, because there is an entire side quest chain and an entire side story tied to Queen's Blood as well. And it is fascinating, actually. So not only are you playing a fun card game, but you are actually engaging with something that is specifically built for this world. If it clicks with you in the early goings on, like, definitely stick with it, seek out the opponents, and see what the story has in store, because it is like I said, I lost a lot of hours to it. I'm sure all y'all did too.
Mm-hmm. It's like if tic-tac-toe was an RTS.
Kind of, yeah.
I think the thing that really hooked me, because initially, like Michael said, like, you're kind of steamrolling it, because like, okay, I get it. I understand how this mm-hmm. game works. It's not too complex up front. But then the second you actually push the side quest storyline forward enough to actually learn what's going on, it was very evocative of a very recent AAA game that I won't name for the sake of spoilers. Yeah. But there was something that happens. I was like, no way. This is nuts. Yeah. And to go back to Michael's, like, how it teaches you, about halfway, not halfway through the game, but like at the point that you get to the gold saucer in the game, if you've been engaging with Queen's Blood, you've probably been steamrolling it up to the point you get to in a gold saucer. But in the gold saucer, the game throws a little zag. And actually, I think Costa del Sol, if I'm not mm-hmm. mistaken, yep. where there's challenges, where instead of playing a full-on game of Queen's Blood, it puts a pre-configured board up of cards that are ready to go. It just gives you like three or four cards, and there is a correct order that you can play the cards in order to achieve some sort of effect. So effectively, you're filling in the blanks. And that does one of two things. One, you win, so it makes you feel nice. And two, it teaches you a mechanic, whether it be depowering enemies, powering up your own enemies, or teaching you how the replacement card mechanics work. Mm-hmm. It all, again, builds together to just mm-hmm. do some wild stuff. And then by the end of the Queen's Blood side quest, you're just doing things that you never thought possible from the original like moments of the game. So it's just so smart and so elegant in its craftsmanship.
Yeah, again, like, massively ambitious, huge anticipated remake of something that's very beloved. You don't want to change too much. People don't like it. And they just injected the totally brand new game in there. Like, this could be like a best-selling game on Steam by itself. And mm-hmm. it's just a part of this game. It's kind of massive. Like,
I would love to play Queen's Blood against other people. Like, I would love to have that as some type of multiplayer component. Like, there'd be so much fun. There'd be so many hours to dunk into that mode.
Physical cards, come on.
Oh man, that would be crazy if we got physical cards. Yeah, and they also have the tail end. There's survival challenges where you have to play multiple rounds with your single deck. So you have to choose, how many cards do I spend in this first round? Do I play all five cards I drew? Or do I save two or three for the next one? Can I make do and win enough points with two cards versus five? And that teaches you to, like, oh, I got to go build a deck to spawn more cards, to destroy other cards, to power up, like Nick was saying. Like, there's just so many things with it. I love it. Ah,
now, so that is one minigame that does things really well. But there's, again, they're not all winners. Like, there's definitely mm-hmm. some that are like, mm-hmm. what? I guess I'm curious, what were your least favorites?
Oh, it was definitely, for me, it was Gambits and Gears. Like, basically, you're controlling these little Wally-looking robots to attack a giant Flan, and it's all programmed by your Gambits, but it's the initial trials are pretty easy, but then the later ones, they add, like, limitations. Like, you can only have two of each color robot, because you get a blue, a yellow, and a red. You can only have two of these, you only get two of these at a time, or two of these period for the whole fight. So you have to like go through and restructure, and it's very kind of, I don't know, automated, like, because it is so automated because of the Gambit system, it wasn't as enjoyable for me.
It's a little too nitty gritty once you start like reprogramming your little robots to have different attacks and different context. It's like, all right, I just want to play the main game again.
Mm-hmm. I think the biggest thing was there just wasn't, I didn't feel like there was enough options. Like, you were so limited in what they gave you. Like, I couldn't stack like just a bunch of fire on all my bots because they only give you one slot of fire casting that you can put on one of your bots. So like, if there was a way to buy upgrades and stuff like that, I think that could have helped me get more invested because I could have felt like I was making the robot my own instead of just, you know, digging my hand in the bag and like, oh, this is what is here.
That is like a very singular granular nitpick, but I feel like that also kind of highlights the flaws that this game has. Like there's so much here. There's like a bunch of little things that are annoying and you almost feel like a jerk for even complaining about them, but there's enough of them that it's noticeable. And like, we're all kind of, I feel like, on the same page about this. Like, Michael, can you sort of explain this?
Yeah, I think when we talked to last week and you described it as like death by a thousand cuts. And I think that's a good way of putting it, because what I wrote in my review is that there are kind of a lot of these little annoying things, but you almost question, like, they're not enough to really be a detriment to the experience, but then you start to question why they're even there to begin with. Like, moving boxes, it's very slowly to either like suck up Mako before you enter a door, which you do so infrequently that's like, all right, I can forget about that. Or like moving a box to reveal a keypad code. I'm like, who writes their keypad code on the wall? And all I have to do is move a box to see it. Like, this, why is this? You could have bypassed this entire thing. And boy, there's one of the later chapters where you, like, they've shown this in the state of play, like where you control Kate Sith and you have to like throw boxes. You go on an elevator and you have to throw boxes at other boxes, and I could just completely ignore it altogether and not worry about it. If you do it well enough, you get like special items, whatever. Mm-hmm. But I was looking at it, I'm like, why was I asked to do this to begin with? And there's like a lot of little things like that. And
they're like micro games, you know, they're not mini games. They have like a gamey mentality, but they're like non-puzzles almost. They're just a thing you do.
They're too long to be convenient though, unlike like a WarioWare micro game. Like, one thing that stood out to me about your review, Michael, is that really personified a lot of really my only issues with Rebirth is a lot of the mini games feel like the equivalent of doing a climbing section in the open world, where it's just like, it's not bad. Like, it's not like a bad, it's fundamentally not a thing that's not bad, but it is a thing that is enough of an inconvenience where you're just like, in a game where so much of it feels good, these moments really stand out because they don't, because they bring the momentum to a crawl.
Mm-hmm. Like, it's one of those things where like this meeting could have been an email. This cutscene should be skippable.
They're all the equivalent of climbing a yellow pathway on rocks. Yeah. A lot of the mini games. Same thing. Same picture.
And you're like, this. It's a nitpick. But there's enough of them that it kind of stacks, and to the point where you're just like, you know, maybe this wouldn't be an 80 hour game if some of the parts is hard to F up, you know, like
reel it back just a little bit. Because like a lot of the stuff in the Gold Saucers, like I don't love all of it. I think like the Star Fox style shooters, kind of whatever. The Punch Out minigame is like actually not great because it's impossible. Yeah. It's almost impossible to read the enemies. You're supposed to react.
I have a tip for everybody who's playing that one and trying to do the harder challenges. You can pause in the middle of their animations. So I literally, as you see them starting to wind up, you just hit the pause button and you can see which arm they're doing, and you just learn kind of positions or whatnot from that. I blew through everybody pretty quick
because that's how basically.
Basically, because that's how you get when you finish one of those. It's one of the best accessory rewards in Final Fantasy, so you'll want to push through those.
Yeah, so like there's a lot of stuff, and like the piano mini game, I think, is actually, it's not a great rhythm game, but I'm glad that it exists. Mm-hmm. And in the same way, like Nick, you mentioned the traversal stuff, like climbing and stuff. I appreciate what it adds to it, but there's a certain level of refinement that those things needed for them to feel like they belong in the game. So, I mean, I think climbing, we've done Uncharted climbing for years and years and years. Mm-hmm. So the fact that this game has it is not a bad idea, because it feeds into the sense of scale you get when you're traversing these environments. Like, wow, the Junon cliffs are huge, and it takes time to get up to a certain vantage point that you want to get to. And I like that it makes you work for that. But man, you got to make that a little bit smoother.
The thing that kind of confused me is at one point you get a grappling hook, and it's just like, oh, but this is only usable in very specific locations. Like, I can't use it to just pull myself to the top of this very short cliff.
It is still the equivalent of slowly rock climbing up. Like, that is like a one-to-one feeling of, I can only do this here, and I have to use this to get way. It's a little faster than rock climbing, I guess, but still.
I can't help but wonder, how many of those things are, like, hiding load times. Like, because they kind of have the same feeling as, like, squeezing through cracks. Like, it's the same level of tedium as that. And it's just, like, a little, you're like, this is not a good grappling hook. This is not, you know, and it's like, I don't know, if you can't do something well, don't do it, you know? Like, you could just run down.
There are significantly less crevice crawling moments in this game compared to Remake, but maybe they are just in the form of yellow rock climbing pathways.
I could see it with like certain moments. There's a couple moments where you climb up to the top of something and then like a cutscene triggers, or you walk a few steps and then it triggers a big thing.
I was positive that the opening chapter one, this is chapter one, so I think this is fair because everybody's played the demo. When you are Cloud and you have to turn the valve, as Sephiroth is going, I was like, why is this the slowest valve turn? And like, part of me is thinking, it was like, oh, I know why this is slowly turning, because significant story content is happening on the other side of this. But no, it's just a slow turn.
It's another thing that was kind of insignificant that I forgot, but now that you brought it back up, I'm like, yes, I remember how. Cloud, you're buff, you're strong, you're a soldier, come on, you can turn this valve faster, man.
It's just that rested weird. It's just that hasn't moved in ages.
There's nitpicks that kind of add up to really you remember those nitpicks throughout the game, but in its biggest moments it almost feels insignificant when you once you finish this game, once you see what this game is trying to say, how it says it. I have a couple of my own qualms with how the main story kind of plays out, but I think by and large that this is it's a powerful story. It's an ambitious story. So all these little things that it kind of might not get right. Boy, does this game like really nail it when it comes to its most important and its biggest moment. So, and especially as someone who's loved Final Fantasy VII since I was a child, man, like it's almost ridiculous to see that this is what Final Fantasy VII has become. So as much as there is valve turning and crevice crawling and throwing boxes at other boxes.
I want to clarify here. Like, these are stupid nitpicks. If anything, I think they're minor. Interesting. Like, they give the game character for all the tedium that goes with them. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just sort of funny to be like, why was that a thing? Like, why was that there? Overall, this game is phenomenal. This game is really, really stunning. And it had expectations are sky high. Like, people really, really, like, they can't screw this up, you know? And they didn't. Like, it just to be perfectly clear, it is a stunning achievement. Like, also, like, I'm trying to tell if this is like the best looking game I've played.
Oh yeah, 1000%, man.
Especially when you get to those CGI cutscenes. Scenes,
the way they blend with like the real-time rendering also is kind of like, oh, it's wild.
Going back to the original PlayStation, right? The cutscenes combined into gameplay, it's a seamless transition. It's so good.
Yeah.
Just fantastic.
I mean, I think people go, what about, what about like The Last of Us Part 2 or PS5 version? And it's like, in terms of a game that is this scale, that looks this good, I don't think I've encountered anything like that. Like, it's really stunning.
Yeah, I mentioned in my review that sometimes, when you're traversing the open world and you're trying to take care of these tasks, the tasks themselves are, pretty fun, or there's things you want to knock out and it's satisfying. But part of that reward of the exploration is to see the views. Mm-hmm. Like, this is a beautiful world. It's also a world ravaged by environmental destruction. And that is one of the core themes, is like climate change and environmental preservation. And you get so much of that story told to you by just looking out to the horizon. When I scale a cliff and I'm jumping on jump pads and flying into the sky, I can see this region in its entirety. And there's so much storytelling in just how this world is built. And it almost reminds me of Xenoblade Chronicles 3, where I will go to an objective, clear it, and then I'll look off to the side of the cliff and see this huge, beautiful world that is actually there for me to explore. And sometimes there's so many photo mode-esque moments in this game. And the fact that it's this in this high fidelity, you know, Xenoblade Chronicles obviously is on a Switch. So the way in which they're able to wield the Switch's limitations to have a world of that scale, but then having 7 Rebirth do it in Unreal Engine 5 with this level of fidelity is so stunning. And like, you know, when you first time you step out to the grasslands and the camera pans and Aerith is like, wow, this world is so beautiful. You get that moment multiple times as the player, because with each region, there is just, it feels like there's something new that you are discovering. Even a barren wasteland like Corel, when you make it to the top of Mount Corel, there's still something awe-inspiring about seeing how this entire world of Final Fantasy VII has been rebuilt visually. And just, it elicits a lot of emotions that are tough to explain.
It does a wonderful job of nailing magical realism. And it's something that I love about this is it the amount of detail that it has in something completely mundane, something totally ordinary. Like, you'll meet NPCs who just look like regular ass people. Like, they're just normal people in this universe. And you know, there's like a guy who has like a regular camera. He's just wearing a shirt. You can get a J. Crew. Like, it's complete. It's this level of like, the fact that there are these mundane elements in this completely fantastical world is, I think that's what's specifically so special about FF7. Like, and obviously other Final Fantasies kind of dabble in this, but there's something here that really is just such a blend of everything, you know. Like, it's got some diesel punk, it's got some cyberpunk, it's got some, you know, classical Western fantasy, it's got, you know, a heavy slathering of just anime sensibilities all over it. Mm-hmm. And then it's got like, they eat their vegetables, you know. Like, I always get critical of stuff where, you know, they want to design the swords, they want to design the spaceships, they want to design the guns, they want to make the cool futuristic stuff, they want to make the stylistic stuff, but you know, there's that same level of attention isn't paid to like the little details, the mundane stuff, you know. Like, nobody wants to render a manila envelope or whatever, but in this game, it's the same level of care is taken across the board on no matter how like, you know, mundane or granular an element is, it's given the same attention and same level of detail as something is like, you know, a giant basilisk or whatever.
Yeah, that's it's definitely part of what makes exploring this world worth it is seeing all those small details, and they definitely add up to say a lot about the world.
It captures the magic of like, as a kid playing through the PS1 version of the game, and you're in the world map walking around, there's just a lot of flat polygons that kind of stick out at funny angles, and it is the approximation of sand, the approximation of grasslands, approximation of, you know, rocky area. And in this game, you get to see the fully fleshed out environment that you imagined was there as a kid. It is like evoking that magical feeling of showing you what you remember it looking like as a kid, even though it didn't look like that at all.
Yeah. No, I have that same feeling so many times going, it's like, oh, this is that moment. This is how I envisioned it. Like, 100%, Nick. Like, that is this game. Yeah, it literally goes places. It does everything. I think it does everything I was hoping for that I was going to get out of this game. Like, the combat is just so fluid. It's just rewarding. The gameplay, the materia systems, the RPG mechanics with the folio / sphere grid system that we're calling it, just everything. You know, like, they've paid so much attention to every single like area, and even things that like I didn't necessarily enjoy, there's still so much detail and design and attention put into those moments that it's just it's crazy. And like I applaud the devs at Square for being able to do that with this game on its scale, because it's just overwhelmingly how good it is for me.
Yeah, I mean, I want to, you know, have valid criticisms, but like, there's also so much to celebrate here. It's It's kind of just flabbergasting that they managed to recreate, like, to realize that idealized version of what we're nostalgic for. Like, this is not, you know, this is not just a remake of a game that exists. It is a realization of a thing that's only ever existed in people's heads. Like,
yeah,
to breathe so much life into something that previously was like, you know, you can make most of the original game out of papercraft, you know, like it doesn't have that many polygons. Like, I would love to see like a breakdown of, you know, like how many polygons are in like one of Cloud's eyelashes or whatever compared to the original game. Like, there's so much life here, and these characters are brought to life so well. It's just, again, you know, there's a fondness for them. Like, it's about these people, it's about these characters and their lives. And it's the thing that I loved about 15 a whole lot, was where it's like you're on a road trip with your pals, you know, and it absolutely nails that. Who is everyone's favorite character? Nick?
Oh. I'm a basic boy. I'm Cloud all the way.
What?
Cloud and Sid.
Okay.
I'm very sad he didn't talk about any of the GDT. The goddamn T. I don't know if I'm allowed to cuss in this. he didn't say goddamn T once in this game. Yeah. I'm so sad.
Yeah. He also doesn't smoke a cigarette anymore.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Like, smoking's bad.
Give the man a cigarette.
you can't smoke cigarettes anymore in video games.
It's just part of his personality. But no, Sid is great in this one too. Of course, that happens later on in the game. But for me, I think especially with Rebirth, I think Barrett is by and far my favorite character. Max, you haven't. You're on the cusp of what's essentially like his chapter. And you know his backstory if you've played the original game, but the way that it's been realized in this game, and it goes into the things you were saying, Max, about like, in my head, this is how I imagined it to be. And then now it's my imagination made reality in this, the form of Rebirth. So seeing like his story has so much more emotional weight to it because of the performances and because of the visuals and the cinematography and a lot of these cutscenes too, especially in his section, are very powerful. And I just love his presence throughout the game and how in small ways, his relationship with the rest of the party kind of evolves to where he's kind of a hard ass and he's there to like do one thing and it's destroy Shinra. But then along the way, you see him kind of have a fondness for everybody else, even someone as annoying as Yuffie. You kind of see things change there. But aside from Barrett, I do like Yuffie a lot, especially with how she controls in combat. I think she occupies like the same brain space as like a Kirby or a Rowlet to me, where she's just like this like happy go lucky adorable person who's just all about one thing, and she's annoying at times, but it's just like, that's my home girl. And like when you control her in combat, I'm like, okay, you need to be switching between all the party members to really get the most out of this combat system. But if I just control her alone, I'm already doing a lot. So I really love what she adds to the rest of this game.
She's kind of like an in-universe weeaboo. Like there's this.
Oh,
there's,
yeah.
There's kind of
very ganky energy.
Yeah, kind of reminds me of like Ed and Cowboy Bebop, where you've got this is this anime person basically who's just like completely goofy and off the wall, and like, and everyone else is just like, what's wrong with you, why are you like this? And this game does such a good job of like, in addition to, you know, capturing the things that we idealized, also taking the completely like goofy elements, not just like subject matter, but like the mannerisms of like a PS1 era polygon waving its arms around, like just this, you know, blocky gesticulation. It does such a good job of doing that with really, really high resolution performance capture. Jada, who's your favorite? Who are your pals?
So I used to be a big Tifa stan. I was all about Tifa all day, every day. But between Intergrade and Rebirth, Yuffie has become my favorite. Like, I just love everything about her, including how she controls in combat, but like just her whole like character, her story, everything that's like that she's about. She's out for materia. She's just along for the ride to get as much materia as she can. And I respect that. She knows what she wants. She's upfront about it to everybody. You know, if she can help turn the tides in this big old battle, sure. but she just really wants some pricey materia. And then a surprise one that snuck up on me that just was, I did not care about in the original back on the PS1, but Kate Sif.
Oh
man, I love his character, just like his accent. Like, it's just, they did such a good job with just his delivery and all his lines. I really hope like that the actor for who's gets nominated for performance on him, because it is just so good. Every line is just over the top and cheesy, corny one-liners. It's just, it's so great. I love Kate Sif in this game. And I really hope like other people enjoy him as much as I did, because yeah. I love him so much more now.
Oh my god, Kate Sif is the definition of whimsical.
Like, yes,
like the Scottish accent is like really, it really adds like this whimsy to the character too. But I just think Kate Sif is so adorable, like the mannerisms, along with the voice acting, and she's a little baby tiger. I love cats so much, and Kate Sif is just a precious little cat. Even though you kind of realize what the truth is behind Kate Sif, is still, oh, you're still cute.
Very fun in combat too.
Yes.
Yep.
You ever want to roll dice?
Rolling them dice.
I love a good gambling class in an RPG.
I can't wait. I haven't even gotten there yet.
Okay. You'll see.
I love Cloud. I love Cloud because he's like, you know, there's the nonverbal protagonist or the silent protagonist. Like Cloud, I feel like has that on a personality level. And like, obviously, you know, he's this like ex-soldier with like PTSD or whatever, but there's so many moments where his entire demeanor reminds me of like one specific scene from The Fifth Element where like Ruby Rod, like Chris Tucker comes in and he's like this flamboyant, he's all over the top and he's like playing the loud music and he's like, and then he interviews like Bruce Willis and he like throws the mic in his face and there's this like, just like deafening silence and crickets. And I feel like that's Cloud's entire, like his entire relationship with everybody is just like, what are we doing? What do you mean I have to put on a bathing suit? We gotta go over here? Oh, I don't want to do this. You know, and, just, and everyone else is like, they got their own thing going on, and you know, and it's endearing. Like it works, and it makes sense in the context of the story. But it's also, it's just, I don't know, it's just hilarious. Like it's a very, it's there's so many moments where he's just like he's, you don't see him rolling his eyes, but you can hear it, you know, like it's just this, you know, I don't know. I like it.
I also think it's like the first time in a game where a character, that is why I like Cloud as well, because he is very nonverbal, but both he and Sephiroth, this is the first game I've ever really noticed a lot of subtlety in the kind of facial animation with both of these characters who don't really talk a lot. And I feel like both Cloud and Sephiroth say a lot with their body language and their kind of micro expressions that they give about. And hats off to the developers.
Say it to me, Sephiroth.
For kind of animating the smallness of different things that they do with their eyebrows, their cheeks, and just it really sells one how Cloud could have looked up to Sephiroth, and also just how Sephiroth became this war hero, this kind of like reluctant war hero, and I think that's super duper smart.
Yeah. Yep. One thing I'll say about that too is the story never really spells out what Cloud is experiencing. And of course that's on purpose because like Cloud's head is clouded and you kind of don't fully understand what's going on with him. But when he has these headaches, when he has these flashbacks, when you know that he's something's off, especially as the game goes on, you kind of, there's so much said in how present he's not with everyone else. And when everyone else is asking, hey, you good, man? He's like, hey, yeah, I'll be all right. And it's like, no, you're not. You haven't been since chapter one, bro. But I can see the things adding up in his mannerisms. I don't know if it's like super intentional, but that is definitely something that came across. And in the original, Cloud talked a lot more. Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, you can't communicate everything in the low poly aesthetic that the PS1 version had, of course, but they've made up for it in other ways to where he doesn't have to say everything outright, but now you can just see how it's worn on his face and his body language and how that takes a toll on everybody else. So it's definitely a game that has a lot of subtleties that speak volumes.
Speaking of characters, did you guys see the Red 13 kind of swap happen?
Dude, it was, I had to like double take with it. It's yeah. It's such a smart choice for that character that I was like,
we need to relax on that.
What was happening, but yeah. We'll take it easy.
I'm not going to talk more about it, but yeah, Red 13 has a big story moment, and it endeared him to me a little bit more than I had in the past.
I'm still 50-50 on it, but I respect it.
Yeah. He's also very strong in combat. Like,
oh my god,
like, Stardust so much
Ray?
Better in combat now. Like, oh, that vengeance, Gage is so good.
Yeah,
Red is he showed up pretty late in Remake, right? Like, he was
tail end.
He was a guest character.
Yeah, like I feel like I didn't really get a chance to get to know him, but this time around, it's like it's kind of like, all right, where were we? Let's pick up where we left off, and I don't know, There's only so much humanity you can breathe into a talking dog, but they do a good job, you know? It works. Ooh, I'm into it.
Yeah. Oh, I'm excited for the rest for you, Max, because, man, it's they do something really special with that character that you just couldn't do in the PS1 version, of course. That is another example, just like Red 13's whole arc is just another example in which this whole Remake trilogy is like building upon the strong foundation that was already there in the original, and still keeping the core ethos of what those games were about, what those characters were about. It's really beautiful to see.
Yeah.
Jada, did we get any listener questions?
Ooh,
I don't want to put you on blast here if you didn't.
I probably did, but give me a second because I am on a different setup than I normally am right now.
I want to go back to talking about the piano minigame.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is a weird thing to call out.
The hardest minigame?
It's
the hardest
minigame in the series. I got to that and I was like dying laughing because like the first thing it did, of course, was just like button mash and just, you know, Cloud sits down like, and like, wow, you did all that? And it was like, no, that's not good music. I was impressed that, like, it reminds me of the Last of Us guitar, where it's like, you guys spent way too much time making a musical instrument in a video game. Okay, you know, why not? Like, it's there. If you want to, like, people are totally going to do, like, insane, you know, they're going to play, like, covers on there. They're going to be like, oh, you know, it's Despacito or whatever, like on piano.
They already have. I saw a My Heart Will Go On cover yesterday. That's with ridiculous. People playing the demo.
Yeah, I'm also just baffled at like the guy who runs like the piano club just looks like Joe Biden with a beard.
Joe Biden, yeah.
What? Like what? Just what a strange character to put in there. I don't know.
It's pretty wild. Like I will say, like, out of all the genres of video games that I am like actually good at, rhythm games are probably the I'm best at. And even then, the way you have to use the twin sticks to get the keys right, and even it'll tell you you're on time and you're great, but when you actually hear it play out, like, this sounds like a 10-year-old child at piano taking piano lessons right now, and everyone's just like, yo, that was amazing. It's very funny. It's ridiculous, and it's
nothing more insulting than hearing the metronome.
Yeah,
something wrong.
Yeah, you get like a 20 hit combo, and then it takes the metronome out. As soon as you mess it up, it's like, hey, you need that back. You need to get back on beat. It's a really goofy thing, but I'm glad that it exists in this game.
Yeah, trying to sort of even quantify the sum of this game's parts, like there's more stuff in here than there is. Like it's overflowing. Like there's such a there's so many little details and little elements. And of course, we're like, the minecart pushing was tedious. I didn't want to do that. The noise it makes when you upgrade folios bothered me. But it's like there's these incredible like character moments and like, you know, big sprawling vistas and like a really good piano. Like it's just there's a lot to unpack here.
Speaking of music, one thing we didn't really get to touch on, but I just would be remiss to not mention once. I at the end of Remake and Intermission, I was like, dude, they used up all the music. How are they going to make new tracks for Rebirth?
Right?
Masashi Haomuzu goes so hard in this game. Just hearing all the tracks that we didn't get to in the original two, in the Remake and Intermission, but also rearrangements of all of the songs that we've heard previously. And it's just like, oh no, Haomuzu's still got it, baby. Yeah. And he goes hard.
Yeah, one thing I have a section about music in every single review that I've ever written, and Rebirth included, because going out, like Persona 3 obviously does music very differently when it's where it's like distinct songs that you would listen to on like an album like that someone puts out, and that way that's woven into the game is really strong and really powerful. Whereas I'm not so taken by sweeping orchestras, but with Rebirth, the way they use leitmotifs and the melodies in so many clever ways where they can either like weave it into an existing song, blend the two together, where you have the Shinra theme with the traditional battle theme blending together as you're going through this dungeon sequence that tells you like, oh, Shinra's on my tail and I know it, that things are dangerous out here, because I know that through the music. And the way they can change character themes, melodies, but switch the pitch up a little bit to be unsettling, to tell you like, I think something is about to go down with Tifa. I think something bad is about to happen with Barrett, because I can hear their theme, but something is off about it. And it's some next level stuff in terms of how, not just the music itself, these are songs that we remember, but how it's wielded is, that is some amazing stuff. Gold Saucer theme and Cosmo Canyon. I like sat on my couch and like cried for 10 minutes straight, because these are songs I listened to when I was 7 years old. I remember what it was like to be 7 years old playing this game. And I was just waiting to hear Cosmo Canyon. And when it hit, it was more beautiful than I could have ever expected.
It did not disappoint. Yeah.
I
had like the biggest, the biggest grin on my face when I got to Gold Saucer and that music started playing. Like it's such a bop. I love it.
Yeah.
Jada, did you get anything over there?
I am attempting to get logged in. If not,
we had some technical stuff going on this last week. Michael, was there anything we wanted to talk about you didn't get a chance to touch on?
I mean, I think it's hard to talk about story stuff because you want to dance around it, right? You want to preserve that. And there's a way to talk about it with preserving the magic and just the actual story beats of it. I will say that it does take a while to get into focus, because as much as I was enjoying like the first two regions and a lot of the mini games, a lot of the diversions and the character building that comes along with it, at a certain point, especially when you hit Costa del Sol, I was kind of like, what are we doing again? Like, what's driving us? I know we're chasing Sephiroth, and I know we're trying to get one up on Shinra. And there's bits and pieces of that throughout the thing. But at the same time, I'm like, okay, like I remember in the original, since these sections weren't as drawn out in the original, the main story was it was right there. I didn't have to wait long to unravel that stuff in the original game. So I don't know if I'd call it necessarily a pacing issue, but it's just how this game is built. So I think that you would need to give it time. And if you played Seven, you're going to see this game all the way through, of course. But I think that the meat of the main story starts to kick in at the, like, around where you're at now, Max. So after that, then you start seeing the ball rolling. And that's when it kind of really comes into focus with what this game is trying to say. And I think this is what the game is always about, you know, saving the planet, you know, of many other things too, with, you know, stopping Sephiroth. That was always the main goal since like day one. And Shinra has always been this ever-present evil there. But I think the way it frames environmental preservation is very powerful in many moments. And it kind of reminds you that I'm glad it does that, because that tells me that they haven't forgotten what this game was really about. So things like that. And also the Turks. I got to mention the Turks, y'all. Like, come on. They're the... Like having this sub villain group that is just perpetually showing up, that they're not, it's hard to call them villains because they're so damn cool. Of course, they're like your opposition, but at the same time, whenever I see Rude show up, Elena, oh my God, Elena has taken my heart.
Did you catch a look at her gun? And not what her gun looks like?
It looks like a Call of Duty weapon.
It's like pink bejeweled with charms and stuff hanging off of it, and like she's like part of this elite military group for Shinra, and she's got this like pink bedazzled gun, and I love it.
There's so many good goofs and gags with the Turks throughout the story that kind of gives them a little bit more character. But when you fight them, there's there's like this level of mutual respect between you and the Turks that mm-hmm. I just love seeing. And you got a little bit of that when you see Root and Reno in Remake. But the way they continue to perpetually just be there is still something. It's one of the things I looked forward to as I was playing the game. Like, oh, when are the Turks going to show
back? They're like a sexier Team Rocket, kind of.
Sure, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Much more buttoned up, much more capable.
With all due respect to Jesse and James, like there's, you know.
Oh, they're great. One thing I do want to talk about is Chadley. Let's talk about Chadley. Yes. Chadley and Mai, the newcomer to the kind of digital interface for training your the training simulator and stuff like that.
Was it like that's all back. Assessment interface or something?
Yes. I believe so. Yeah, I believe that is what Mai stands for. I felt like in the first one, Chadley was like kind of a distraction. It's like, oh, this is how I get my summons. Okay, whatever. He's still very much the case for here, but I feel like they gave him so much more character and so much more to do around him. And they built him so much into the side activities that it really got a chance to let Chadley shine. Mm-hmm. And it's just a great way of building upon the foundation they put in Remake. And some of those later challenges get really tough.
Oh yeah.
Like you just have to kind of build full sets of materia around specific challenges, especially when you get to like the 10 battle ones towards the end of the game. Like they're ridiculous.
They're really fun though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They are. Yeah. So really, much fun. Really fun.
We checked in like last week, and I was like, I want to take Chadley on a date to the gold dumpster. Like I hate Chadley. And he's great. And the thing you called out was like, he keeps showing up in increasingly ridiculous places. Mm-hmm. And like mm-hmm. right after we got off that call, I played a little bit more and I was like, okay, fine. That's really funny. That's like a really good goof for him. Just like, and it's just,
I know exactly what you're talking about.
What is that? I'm trying to think what that reminds me of. That's like, there's like a bit in some game or some show where like somebody's just, how did you get here? Where did you come from?
Don't worry about it. I'm here. It's all that matters.
Chadley definitely grew on me because I was like, all right, he calls me every time I pull up on a life spring, every time I discover something new, where I was like, hey, Cloud, I see that you discovered new intel. Should come back and check out this new material I got for you. I'm like, all right, relax, man. I know what I'm doing. Then as the game goes on, where you're just like, hey, yo, it's Chadley's here. This is like,
he reminds me of the merchant mm-hmm. in RE4. That's what it is.
There he is. Yep. 100%. And Mai is like basically a Pokedex. Is basically like, you'll go up to, you have these like special fiends that you'll hunt throughout the game. And Mai will give you just like, this is the whole background on these ones. These ones weren't able to didn't find a mating partner, so they've changed their color. This is a perfect chance for us to examine these new species.
Yeah.
like it's just great. She does that for like all the big, those odd fights, which are cool.
Nice. Well, we are about at time here. Yeah, Final Fantasy VII Rebirth. It is a massive, huge game. There's lots to talk about. We'll probably be talking about more of it. Michael, thank you so much for joining us. Where can people find you?
You can find me and all my stuff at Michael P. Higham on Twitter or at Higham Michael on Instagram. And you can check out some of my work on IGN.com, Hit Video Game website, and GameSpot.com every now and then as well. You know what I'm saying? They're still the homies, so I'm out there doing it.
All right. Well, thank you so much for hopping on. Nick, Jada, always a pleasure as usual. And on that note, Beyond.
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 Beyond.